Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
We are now on our second day of our OPAC meeting. It is September 21st, 2018. This is the Oregon Ocean Policy Advisory Council meeting, day two. So thank you all for coming back. I hope you had a good evening. We are going to quickly go around the room just so for the record, people introduce themselves. We don't have to do it as laboriously as yesterday, but you can say your name and then in one word what you did with your extra half hour. In one word. Laurel Hillman, Oregon Parks and Recreation Department.
Richard Heath from Brookings. I represent the Southfield Charter Sport and Recreation Fishermen.
Karen Brady, Oregon Department of Fish and Wildlife. Breakfast.
John Holloway, North Coast Sport Fishing. Food.
Did I arrive just in time?
Yes, sir. Introduce
yourself. Bob Manning, South Coast County Commissioner from Coos County.
Susan Chambers, South Coast Commercial Fisheries Rep, and I worked.
Charlie Plyvin, Coastal Marine Fishing Recreation, and I had the conference call.
Steve Shipsey, Council to the Council, and Kathy.
Gina Carter, the Coastwide Conservation Seat, and I did laundry.
Walter Chuck, Port Marine Transportation Navigation, work.
Jack Thompson, North Coast County Representative and Fishing.
Patty Snow, Coastal Program Manager, DLCD, work email.
Jamie Faraday, Public Representative, Coastal,
Ryan.
Melissa Kaiser, Coastal Conservation Environmental Organization Seat. And coughed-a-lot. Sorry in advance for the coughing.
Kevin Dunn, North Coast Commercial Fisheries.
Andy Lanier, OPAC staff, troubleshooting.
Lorenda Dehan, OPAC support. I slept in.
Woo!
Everybody wanted to do that, I know.
Anna?
Anna Husing, Director of the Lincoln County Planning and Development Department.
Deanna Carciolo, unattached, dog walking.
Rocky Schultz,
not until October 1st.
Dave Fox, Oregon Department of Fish and Wildlife, coffee.
Nice.
Charlotte Whitefield, ODFW, and I slept in.
You're just chuckling at the end because you make it sound like you're at a dating show. Yeah. Is there anyone else on the phone, Andy?
We have four participants on the phone. We have Chris joining us remotely. Hi, Chris. I believe she has the ability to unmute herself. We also have John Schott. From the Bonneville Power Administration.
So it says we have John Shaw and Chris Wall on the phone. Is there anyone else? I guess you have to raise your hand for it to say. Okay. So we're going to spend the first hour of our day together just recapping a little bit from yesterday and then talking about moving forward. And one of the things that these are some reflections of what I heard yesterday, and what I'm hoping we can do is add to the list or get different perceptions that you may have had. But it seems to me that in terms of follow-up activities or kind of findings from yesterday, a lot of it was educational, but it seems to me that there's some outdated language in the territorial sea plan, particularly part one, that could be updated. We heard a couple of times that the issues survey process outlined in part one could maybe be re-energized and utilized in some way to either inform our work or to keep us more abreast of the issues that are facing the coast on a more regular basis. We heard that there are a need for educational materials to help the public understand the harvesting plan. There might be a request coming in the future for part four to address the need for inspections for cables. There is a need to align all the various pieces that discuss part three and try and coordinate and shore up how that amendment process may work. And then, of course, as we'll hear today, there's a need to review part five. And depending on what the commission does next week, and if they send it back to OPAC, that will definitely be on our workload. So I'm going to pause here and see if folks have any other ahas or findings or summaries from yesterday that struck you that we should make sure we capture. Richard.
During the part three discussion yesterday, I heard some ideas about reviewing projects that were done within that to kind of give us a more better understanding of what sort of permitted activities there are, which then could help with the review process. I think that I thought that was a really good idea to kind of help us document what's actually.
Just to add to that, I think what I heard that paralleled what Richard said is the need a periodic summary of the activities, more frequent summary.
And so on that more frequent summary, I think one of the things we discussed was, you know, the need kind of a more regular check-in or update of the different sections of territorial sea plan, like whether it's 3 years or 5 years or 7 years, whatever. But what I definitely heard yesterday was a desire for more information on an annual basis. And I guess one of the things I want to understand is, are we looking for metrics like this many permits were approved, these kinds of activities happened, kind of a look back report of the year? Or are we looking for a summary of the issues? Like a new issue facing us is drones and it's become a real problem. And so do you understand the difference of what I'm saying? And I'm sort of trying to understand what you think would be helpful. Charlie?
Different questions, Charlie.
Richard?
I think both would be helpful because you don't look at what's actually happening and what sort of permitting is being done within the scope of this process. It's just a process, just a sterile document. There and says, so we have all these parts, but until we know exactly how that relates to everyday activity, I think that will help bring it to life. So we understand that, well, when we did this, it's going to require people to do these things. And here's what the actual activities are. So I think a summary like that would be very helpful.
Bob?
I would echo what Richard says, have both. Issues coming up, but also what has happened, who's doing the permitting, and what they do. It's a, not just a list, but a little more in depth. This was XYZ Tower Company applying for, and they did such and such.
Melissa?
And I agree with you both, and I think it'll be a little bit more extra work for various subcommittees, but or committees, but I think it's doable and it'd be really beneficial to all of us, especially us new members, even if we're on those subcommittees.
Walter?
Yeah, I just want to clarify, are you talking about committees reporting back to the PAC or the agencies?
I personally was envisioning the agencies.
Oh, okay.
Having the agencies report on what, because we don't see all the permits that they deal with or all the companies that intersect with, like if an energy company came and chatted with them and then looked at the territorial sequence and said, man, this seems too hard to go somewhere else, but we would never see that. So it's more about them capturing that. So that what Richard's saying is we understand how people are interacting with the territorial sequence. And if it's good, it needs fixing, whatever.
And are the committees primarily doing that work with the reporting? That was kind of my mindset, or are the agencies directly reporting back?
I would imagine, I'm making this up, but I would imagine
a follow-up. I'd like to ask Andy and just maybe the agencies to maybe come to us in the next meeting, what's actually doable, you know, without putting too much of a load on them.
Yeah, so I think there's two thoughts. One is that the kind of interest that I'm hearing around the table is very similar to interest from the Oregon Ocean Science Trust Board in getting some kind of statement of the ecosystem or statement of Oregon's ocean each year. And so this is a theme that is mirrored in that body. It's also a theme that's mirrored in the Pacific Fisheries Management Council, and we have an annual report that NOAA develops through the Fishery Science Centers for the council process that includes a lot of data analysis for reflecting on what the ecosystem is doing, what the fisheries are doing, what the communities are doing in terms of performance on the fisheries management plans, just as an example. And that one is way far on the spectrum of a whole lot of work. Like, they have two or three or four FTEs that spend months doing that. So that's not what we're talking about here. I think we're more on the spectrum of kind of capturing some metrics. And I think the annual snapshot is very valuable. I think that OPAC as a group and the Ocean Science Trust as a group might have a lot of overlap in interest. And I think that the more clear OPAC can be about what is of value, the more the agencies can respond and saying, yes, this is doable, or no, this isn't doable. Because it can go from, you know, a couple of days of work to a couple of months of work very easily. And it wouldn't be necessarily the intent of this group to push it to that end, but it can quickly expand. So.
I think that what you're talking about is way more of an analysis type report that you're providing for those entities, and I think it would be smart for this group to be talking to at least the Ocean Science Trust with respect to what we're asking of the agencies, particularly as it relates to, as I see the Ocean Science Trust and the convergence of this, potential projects that may come out of or a need for funding. But I don't see this as much as a state of the health of the ocean, I think is what you are indicators of. I mean, the Territorial Sea Plan is a document to coordinate the actions and the vision of Goal 19. And I think it doesn't need to be so analysis driven, but just sort of the primary things we're hitting on now. It might have been easier to address every 3-4 years rather than once every 25 years. I think that's, so we can integrate priorities that we have right now and go back into.
Wow. Your phone.
Bob, you're killing me. You're killing the monologue here.
It was purely intended.
I see things like the GLD discussion with offshore oil, you know, that's not something that would pop up, I don't think, in the Ocean Science Trust. These are more kind of law of the sea issues and less sort of science project driven issues. Is that?
And that's why I'm saying that we need to be really clear about what would be of value to OPAC and be very precise in what we're saying that we want in an annual report so that it isn't redundant
with some of these other things. So we're on the same page, Charlie. Andy? Yeah, so as I sit here and listen to the conversation, I'm sensitive to the two ends of the spectrum. And as it's written in the Territorial Sea Plan, it's an issues survey that's associated with implementation of the plan. So I think it should be targeted to, was there activity under TSP Part 2? Was there activity related to TSP Part 3? And those should be pretty closely focused to the activities on the ground. For part three, it should be correlated with the kinds of activities associated with Rocky Shores management, maybe potentially creeping over into current studies that might be ongoing. But that's maybe where you're getting into the more work end of the spectrum. But part four, was there a cable application? Was there part five? Was there a marine renewable energy application? And I think that should be kind of the big benchmarks that we set for this kind of annual report.
Maybe what we want to do is just flag this and have you all come back with a proposal that we can take around. Here's what we think a draft issues survey or report would look like. Do you like it? What don't you like? Give us something to react to. Unless there's anything else on the topic, I'm going to jump back to Charlie's question, which he's kindly held this whole time.
Well, I was just going to say that as a recommendation so that we don't let this bleed out forever, but for our next meeting to come back with a recommended strategy that the council can review. And if that's too much for the agencies, then would you like OPAC participation in that?
I think my only concern is that DSL isn't here and they hold a lot of the permits, so we don't have Chris to tell us his thoughts on that. Between now and the next OPAC meeting, there is an Ocean Science Trust meeting. I want to say it's the 19th of October, Friday. And so I think that would be worth just, you know, posing to them. I'll be there talking about the urgent simplification and complexity of council. So if this group wanted to kind of tee up, not the TSP specific stuff, but the just kind of annual report kind of concept with them, I'd be happy to. But I think that Andy and Chris as a team would need to get together and talk about DSL's thoughts on this.
Can we just
answer the question?
Can we just agree to have Andy coordinate something? Okay. He can figure out how to do it among the agencies and bring us back a draft to look at.
Allocate this to you. Since you're big enough.
We've spent a bit of time putting together priorities for OPAC. We've made committees out of those priorities, and I think we owe it to ourselves to reflect those priorities in the territorial seed plan. I think that you can get a group of people around that document and spend 5 years trying to do that. Or one person could probably, whether that's a fellowship or whether that's an individual that wants to take it on, could probably go through and make some administrative updates to reflect OPAC's priorities where possible in the territorial sea plan. And I think this is very high level, but it would be pretty easy actions. It would actually be moving on things like recommendations from the OAH, which say to sort of institutionalize strategies for OAH and actions for OAH within planning and guidance documents. The territorial sea plan will be one place that could happen. So at the very least, I would make the recommendation that we do that for OAH. I think it would be great to check out all of our sort of strategies and have some high-level review of the TSP.
So one other thing I want to bring up is the fact that in April, you'll recall, we had a facilitated visioning session, and we appreciate the help in doing that. And we came up with a number of ideas about what we wanted to do in the future. I'm just going to run through them really quick, kind of the high-level ones that came out. But one of them was, is there a role at OPAC for an oil spill response plan and in the territorial sea plan? What is our link with the Ocean Science Trust related to science priorities, which you heard as a theme here this morning? Helping with actions with OAH, commercial kelp, seaweed harvest, and aquaculture. That was a big topic we discussed. Dredging, offshore oil and gas development. I don't know why this came up after Scott's presentation after the Bessie Farm. It says an inventory for cables and where they're buried or not. It came up out of vision. And an inventory for infrastructure. structure overall, what's in the territorial sea, and then also, of course, marine reserves came up. And so one of the things that we discussed at that meeting was developing a chart that outlined kind of with some criteria, the sense of urgency on those different issues, what a work plan would be, in terms of scope, is it a teeny task, is it a big task, what the cost might be, and then bringing that kind of chart back to us to discuss where we want OPAC to go in the future. Like, what are the next issues we're going to tackle after we address Part 5 and after we wrestle with Part 3? What's the future of OPAC? And so in doing so, one of the things I'd like to do is suggest the issues that came out of yesterday be rolled into that discussion. So if we wanted to update Part 1, let's put it in there as part of this, let's develop a work plan about what that might look like. And then bring all of that back to OPAC for its consideration. So, and some of these ideas, we have a lot more notes about why they're brainstormed, so we'll go back to that and be more specific than the list I just gave you. But I want to get your reaction to that idea of bringing back what might be short-term versus long-term priorities for OPAC to tackle. And with some criteria, like I said, urgency, impact, cost, Terry.
Related to cables, you need to talk to Scott. Remember, there's security issues around this, and we tell generally where it's at. We don't always give the detailed information of exposures and things like that. There's other people in the world that may sometimes want that information, and so we try to keep it close enough to be pertinent, but not.
Process for OPAC or a one-meeting process? Like, what is it actually entailed in these different tasks? And so we bring back more information about, based on your ideas, what that might look like. And when there's confusion, we have to address it. Maybe the idea of an inventory for cables is just, we should just cut it. But we'd be able to have that discussion.
You can have a discussion. Just put it broad-based, but make sure he's involved in any discussion.
So any reactions to that? And then we would probably tackle that, honestly, at our spring meeting, based on how things are stacking up for our next agenda. Under general, yay, apathy, no, Maria. Johnson, help me out.
Probably not really. I've been down this road with other planning bodies and all that, and my warning is keep track of all this because this is a workload issue, and it's fine to have a list of things you'd like to do and maybe prioritize them, but nobody can do everything at once. And with the federal council, we end up with important things not getting done because we've added too much to the workload, so I don't have any useful advice other than that.
I agree with what John just said. That's not a surprise to anybody, but I also agree that having bare bones information about what the scope and urgency and discrete characteristics about each of these ideas in front of the council before we make a decision on what we're going to do is critical for managing workload, right? So if we see that something is too expansive, too expensive, something that will feed into our decision making versus just having a topic that we might all be passionate about and want to do and then we get over our heads.
Melissa?
They're so far away. It's good for my cough. Yeah, I agree. And again, as a new member, having something that's more of a broad brushstroke of issues that are really pertinent to this group would be beneficial to me. And just to know what those relationships are, like OSTA, OSTA is like the correct acronym, the Oregon Science Trust.
No.
It's Oregon Science Trust, that's a different thing. So yeah, I think that would be really beneficial, but I don't see there being a need right now for there to be a ton of depth for that workload to be necessary.
Great point. And I also think we're not committing to it. That's the whole point of looking at it, to see what we want to do and if and when. So build upon that and inform our discussion. Okay. Any other thoughts about that or anything that you think we missed from yesterday?
I have in my notes part G of the policy. Ocean management goals and policies. I think Andy brought this up that we're lagging in that in part B that says it is the policy of the state of Oregon to prepare and regularly update a marine resource strategy and see that, that's lagging. That should be a priority. Is that right?
There's no chat at the moment.
Okay, great. So with that, we are a little bit ahead of schedule. And I had one thought that I just wanted to share about follow-up on yesterday on federal consistency. Too close. Federal consistency and enforceable policies. I think it was pretty clear that federal consistency and enforceable policies won't help us in everything. For example, if the state wants to, let's say, we don't want oil and gas development in the territorial sea, actually, we have a current statute that does that. That is not something that we could have as an enforceable policy because it prohibits a whole type of activity. But it's still, you know, it's the policy of the state, and that's fine. But I did want to reaffirm that I believe federal consistency is a very powerful tool. It's just not going to be the tool for everything. So just wanted to clarify that.
I mean, I think one other finding that came out of yesterday, and maybe I got this wrong, but I think it was surprising to some people to know that the 2009 Part 5 things had not been filed as enforceable policies. And so I guess that's another finding from yesterday that that emerged and helped provide clarity about why having Part 5 invalidated at this point is a challenge. So, there's no action item out of that, so I didn't list it. But, Melissa?
And if we're a little ahead of schedule, I had a question for clarity's sake, and I didn't realize that I didn't know this. But Andy, you were talking about the Oregon seaward boundary, and it's starting at the end of any offshore islands. I thought it started anywhere along the coast at the mean high tide line. Is that not correct? So it starts, like, if there's an offshore rock or island, like Haystack Rock, it starts, that 3 miles, 3 nautical miles, starts at the backside, west side?
It starts on the westernmost point of land within the state of Oregon. And those offshore islands are included in the state of Oregon.
Okay.
So therefore, it bumps the territorial sea out westward.
Any of those offshore islands?
Yeah, just imagine that you have a cannon on the westernmost point of each island. And that was, the 3 nautical miles was the distance a cannon could shoot.
Okay.
And that's the origin of that metric for our territorial sea.
Okay.
And the nation's territorial seas in general.
Except for Florida, which has 9 miles.
Yeah.
Texas.
I did not know that, so thank you. Okay, just wanted to clarify and make sure.
Yeah,
I always thought it was me.
So
So the only other part that I would bring up with from the discussion we had with Liz and Chris up there was when we're making policy and policy advisories, is that there's a difference between making policy and also, and I take this kind of under the part working with agencies, that we need to, as the council, as members, we need to be very careful when we're working on these policies that we don't give too many agency directives in them, because what we ask them to do can increase their workload, and it's not that we don't, we shouldn't have this information, we should be cognitive of what we're of the agencies when we want these things, and not to overload their workload, because when we ask them, say, we say must, shall, or will, there's a big difference in those words, and then when we, if we ask for that, they're going to have to give it to us, and it might be increasing their workload, because you need to be cognitive of that.
Great, thank you. So we are moving ahead with our agenda, but we are currently missing our speakers, who must all be in the hall together. I saw them all, some of them sitting
here. You want me to get up?
Yes. So while we have a few minutes here, I think what we're going to talk about is our next meeting. So here, there's important actions related to part five, and there is a desire to make progress on it from OPEC's side if the commission decides to send it back to us. So we are going to talk about some potential meeting dates. We had talked originally about aligning our meeting with the commission's meeting in November, but it is overlapping with AOC and a number of other important events. So we were talking about potentially looking for an alternative date. If it comes back to us and the 155-day clock starts, I feel like we have two choices. We can either try and tackle it soon, which means trying to meet before the commission meeting in mid-November, which means having a late October or early November meeting, or it means trying to meet before their January meeting, and then so we meet in early January. And so those are our two kind of choices within the 155-day time frame, where then the commission would have an opportunity to act after the end. So I want to just get a sense of, do we want to try and tackle this in 2018 and get part five done? Do we want to wait until the new year? And of course, we'll send out a doodle poll, but we're just trying to get a general sense of where you'd like to have a meeting. And there's no right or wrong answer. So I'm just going to go around and have people say your preference. You'd rather have something in 2018, and we'll try and get lucky and find a date, Laurel, or we need to wait till January.
I'm not sure how much work it's. Is this a one meeting?
Yes.
I mean, one day meeting. Do you have any idea how long it's going to take? Yeah. Is there going to be working groups preceding it that you have to schedule, or just the?
I don't anticipate that. And also, the other thing that's in my mind is that the Part 3 group would like some action and decisions and participation at some point, so that's weighing on whether we should meet again in 2018 versus 19. And Charlie, you may have a perspective on that if you want to try and sway votes one way or the other. Or not. Is Charlie speechless?
No.
All right, then.
I mean, my preference is I don't care. I do have a big event on one of the days that you were considering.
I don't think the 15th is working for many people, so we'd have to find an alternative date, like the first week of November, for example. We'll have to find something else in 2018 with those particular dates. So I guess I'm just trying to ask if you want to try and do that. I've heard a number of people say yes, we should try and tackle it. It'd be expedient dealing with Part 5.
I think you should.
Okay, so that's what we're on. Laurel. Laurel is as.
I said I would.
I think we should do it in 18, remembering that next year legislative session. So early in that process, a lot of agencies are hearing for that. So it would be, I think, a group of
days. Yeah, I agree with that. However, moving it even a week early in November is problematic. We have the Pacific Fisheries Management Council, which is a very intensive, about 10 days just prior to where the meeting is set now.
was looking at the calendar. The first full week of November is filled with elections, Cofield Tribe, Confederated Tribe, channel modification, etc. Then AOC's the next week for all week. Then the following week on Thursday is Thanksgiving, but we have meetings on that Tuesday, the 20th and the 21st. Shot for
yeah, we're definitely not going to be able to find a date that works for sure. I'm just trying to get a sense of what we should attempt 2018. So far, I have two yeses.
Early December is good.
I guess I should have asked a question earlier. I'm not sure I understand the need to have this be coincident with an LCDC meeting.
It doesn't have to.
I heard you mention that for January as well, and so if we say, okay, let's talk about the first 2 weeks of December.
Oh yeah, no, I'm just saying 2018 in general.
Okay.
We could meet in December.
Okay, I wasn't clear on that.
Yeah, no, I'm just saying if we take an action, then the commission takes it after us, and so, you know, at some point they're going to need to take action after us, and so I'm just in cognizant that we are going to model that. Just forget that point. At some point in 2018, we would look for a date, maybe December.
Just to clarify that the commission meets every other month, so if the last one this year is in November, so if OPAC took its action sometime in 2018, then also we could presumably take action in January.
Okay. Susan? John? Again, we're not trying to pick exactly here, we're just like 2018.
Especially with what Karin talked about, the council meeting, and I'm thinking December would be better. I like 2018 better than waiting until January.
Thank you.
Yeah, I think 2018, we make it work. I think we heard some urgency from the public. We heard urgency for some other reason why 2009 recommendations weren't adopted, or of course, we'll call it sign. The sooner the better.
If it works earlier, 18.
Terry's not.
2018.
That's the first time that's happened in our whole 18. Speakers that are going to present, and so our first presenter, I don't know if you all want to come to the panel, or maybe one by one, Andy. And we're giving each speaker approximately 15 minutes.
If you don't need all that time, that's fine. You don't have to lose it. I did bring some yellow cards and red cards, so if you get close to the end, I'm going to yellow card you, and then I'll hit you with the red one when you're beyond your 15 minutes. So with that, you all met Andy yesterday from the Coastal Program. Super smart guy.
So, we don't have one of our panelists yet, so I'm hoping that he will be here shortly.
Yeah.